representing Kenya today, which means that different countries, but one Africa. What country are you representing today?
One Africa, one African people throughout the world. So these Berlin Conference fragments, I don't call them countries anymore, I call them cages. So when you try to go from Ghana to Togo, they'll ask you if you have a pass from a white man that will allow you to go to a new cage. So me, I don't deal with these cages because my ancestors even, they were enslaved long before any of these cages existed. So I represent all black people throughout the world, regardless of location.
Wow, this is gonna be an interesting episode. My name is Maya, and what is your name?
Nana Kwame Pebi Dati Odikain, Bamuchida Mhene Aiwa Ekwepi Mampon. And I'm also known as Okunini Obadile Kambon. So I've given you my traditional title as Bamuchida Mhene, and then also my birth name, Obadile Kambon.
I feel like you're a king, like in Ghanaian culture. Like the way you've dressed, I think somebody see you will think that you're a king. Are you a king?
Yes, Chidom Hene, so Bamu Chidom Hene at Ekwepi Mampon.
Ekwepi Mampon.
Yeah.
Where were you born?
I was where or when?
Where exactly?
Okay, so I was born in Brooklyn, New York, 1979, June 16, 1979. But I didn't live there long. We moved when I was about 1 year old to North Carolina. Okay. And my parents' plan was, one, if you're interested in African liberation, you can't do much but talk about it if you're living in New York, because you're dependent for your water, for your food, for your transportation on the exact same ones who you're trying to get free from. So they decided to move to North Carolina to build their own log cabin in the woods, to grow their own food, to, you know, have their own water supply and everything else. So that's how we grew up in a very rural setting, maybe about 30 to 40 minutes outside of Raleigh, North Carolina, which is the capital. Their plan was to go from there to the Caribbean, because North Carolina is where my mother's side of the family was enslaved, and then the Caribbean is where my father's side of the family was enslaved, specifically St. Kitts and Barbados, and then their eventual plan was to come to Africa. So for me to be here, I'm actually fulfilling the rest of their initial plan.
So you moved to Africa. Is Ghana your first destination?
I've actually been to about 12 or 13 countries in Africa, but Ghana was the very first place that I came to in Africa. Besides Ghana, Burkina Faso, Mali, Togo, Benin, Nigeria, Gambia, the Gambia, Senegal, La Côte d'Ivoire, Kenya, Ethiopia, Egypt, South Africa. I feel like I'm missing something, but that should give you.
Okay. Yeah. But, you know, the way you've dressed, I've seen you like the whole of today. This is what you've been wearing the entire day.
I hope that's what I mean.
I had to go and look for my own for this interview. Why do you dress like this?
Because I'm African, right? And when we think about things, just in terms of the economic warfare that's being waged against African people, is that we're given various created tastes and desires. And what I mean by that is that the exact same ones who enslave and colonize us tell us that our clothes are no good. So once we basically internalize that idea, now who do you have to go to get the clothes that are good? The same ones who've been enslaving and colonizing you. So now they take the money from you financing them just from a taste, just from a desire, and then they use that to build the prisons, the bullets that shoot us down in the streets, the bombs that they bomb Africa with. And all of it comes, not all of it, but a good portion of it comes from all the Africans you see walking day by day. They've given billions and billions in what's effectively aid to the exact same enslavers and colonizers. So for me, you know, primarily economic, but, you know, in other aspects too, but understanding this as actually economic warfare. So it's not, oh, this looks cute, it's that, no. I'm supporting my own African people, and when I do that, now instead of financing my enemies to the tune of billions and billions, that same money can go to other African people.
Africa for Africans.
That's right.
You believe in that?
Exactly, yes.
Do you think all black people are from Africa?
All black people are Africans, and all Africans are black people. Matter of fact, when I write it, I use the equal sign. I say African equals black, and I write Africa with a K, just so people are not confused, because you have all of these fraudsters who are trying to hijack the term Pan-Africanism. Mm. Now, if you look at those who invented the word Pan-Africanism, coined the word, in the 1900 resolution from that conference that was held in England, they actually mentioned specifically countries like Haiti, like Liberia, Ethiopia, and any others that emerged. They mentioned, so for them, they're already talking about not just those who happen to be on the continent, but all black people. So they use the word African, black, and Negro interchangeably. So for me, when you're down with the real Pan-Africanism, not the fraud Pan-Africanism, you're talking about black people regardless of location. Unfortunately, Pan-Africanism, the term, has been hijacked by these fraudsters who mean location, whether or not you're black. And recently we've seen that with the AU, when they allowed Morocco in 2016, who applied to join the AU, that they were admitted, while Haiti, who was mentioned by those who invented the word Pan-Africanism, they applied to join, and they were rejected on the grounds that they are not located on the African continent. So for me, that's anti-African, it's anti-black, and it's against everything that Pan-Africanism is about. And basically you have these people who are trying to get rid of Pan-Africanism altogether and come with that idea, what they call all Africanism. So it means excluding black people who aren't located on the continent, yeah, and then incorporating the Arab enslavers. And when you look at a place like Morocco, they use the exact same word for slave and black person, it's abid. For them, there's absolutely no difference. If they mean black, they mean slave. If they mean slave, they mean black. But then this is who was allowed into the AU. Yeah. And the only deliberation was how well they're treating other Arabs in Western Sahara. Not a single discussion about the enslavement of black people there.
Wow. Let me know. You see yourself as an African. Mm-hmm. Right now you live in Ghana. Mm-hmm. Do you have a Ghanaian passport or American passport?
I actually have a Ghanaian passport, and let me show you if you're interested. So a couple of years ago, 2016, mm-hmm, 34 of us, we had our citizenship restored, and I use that in the term that on my opinion, Mahama used. So he said, I'm not giving you anything, I'm restoring what's rightfully yours. So we hold on to that, and this is actually it right here, the Ghana passport.
Yeah, when you're talking to me, I heard you saying, Omanpein, yeah, Mahama.
Omanpein, Mahama.
My tree is not coming out. I speak fancy, you know?
When you're ka fancy.
Okay, maybe before Kassan, I can buy a hint.
Yoruba, Wolof, Kiswahili, Kikongo, and no titiri Nadia Kano, a yen crank Casa Mitmichia, Ever Casa Mitmichia, Dogon Casa Mitmichia, Bamana Casa Mitmichia, Casa Hondo Bibri, and Nadia
Swahili, and when you're a cameraman, you're more Tanzania and Kenya.
Sawa.
Hey! What's your because people say, oh, I'm sure, and I'm sure, say, in fact, what can Sakasana? And Bessa won't name a cameraman, Ekasana Mushadi.
Sawa. Abore Zadion.
Zuri San is a cockle.
Zuri San.
Okay.
Gina Lakunan.
I asked him if he has been to Tanzania before.
Umeshafika Tanzania?
Hapana. Lakini nitasafiri kwa Kenya.
Oh, he says that like he has already traveled to Kenya.
Mm.
Lakini.
Asking him, how did he manage to learn Swahili?
Umejifunza vipi Kiswahili?
Nilijifunza Kiswahili kwa chuo kikuu cha Morehouse, ni Atlanta.
Studied Swahili the University of Morehouse.
Atlanta.
Atlanta.
Atlanta, American.
How about other question?
And apart from Swahili, you speak Wolof.
Wolof.
Nagandef.
Jamre kana. So buge minna ni wax tan ci Wolof bu baxa baxa baxa.
No, no.
That's the only.
All I know is Nagandef.
Jamre.
Wow. And Amharic? You speak Amharic?
Amharic. I can order food in Amharic because the main context I've learned Amharic is in Ethiopian restaurants.
Yeah.
So I can say things like un miso wat falekalu, wa falekalu, kikalicha falekalu. Like these types of things.
I'm really
conjo,
impressed.
Like
conjo.
Yeah.
Yena conjo.
Yeah.
And there's one. Oh, I forgot. I'm a Seganalo.
Existing. Is there your Mexican? All of those ones. But those I don't count any of those.
Okay.
Right? So like If there are languages that I can just do small in, then I could count maybe about 50 of those. but I don't count those as like languages I speak fluently.
Would you say that Africans should try and embrace their own language, especially if you go to so many African countries like the East Africa, some of them have started like using Swahili in classrooms and stuff, but when you come to Ghana, English is in classroom. Is there anything you want to say about that?
You know, when I was in Kenya, I was so impressed because I was like, these people are serious, because when you look at the signboards, things are in Kiswahili actually, so this is the cho, this is, you know, everything. So I said, wow, these people are actually serious about being African. I had people who were in Kenya and was like, it's not so great, but you know, if I compared, you know, at least that language policy with what we have in Ghana, you know, Ghana is light years behind as far as that goes. They defend themselves. And this is my son, Kweku. As you see, he likes to steal the spotlight. He'll just hop up in here.
Yeah.
Kweku, chia.
Good thing.
Yeah. Kweku, can you speak Kiswahili? Moja. Kumi. Sawa, pongezi. Hongera. Yinka mochi. Bakon. Yinka mo Yoruba na.
Baka Yoruba.
Oko.
Oko eti da eta e an e ba eti eti eka sa.
Eson.
Ewa.
Okare. Okonla.
Okonla eti da.
Before I remember what happened, I wanted you to tell us, like, there are a lot of black brothers out there, or black brothers and sisters out there who are looking forward to move to the motherland. Is there any message that you have for them, since you're saying Africa is for Africans? Any message you have for your fellow Africans out there?
Yeah, so we actually have started an initiative called repatriatetoghana.com.
Okay.
So with this, we're actually assisting Africans with everything from just advice to actually on the ground, helping them go to the Lands Commission, you know, go for citizenship and all of the things of that nature. So because we started that initiative of African Studies, there was an elder, Dr. Mawalana, who really spearheaded it. And it was through the office, my office at African Studies, that the first 34 were able to get their citizenship. And then also these, this next batch that's about to get it, all of their forms came to me initially. It's since gone on to Dr. Mawalana, and like I said, he's been absolutely, you know, indispensable for this process and really, you know, spearheaded it. But these are some of the things that we're doing to actually assist Africans. It's not enough to just beat people over the head and say, oh, you should repatriate. But it's like, well, how do I do it? You know, what job will I have? How will I take care of myself? How will I take care of my family? And what we're doing is we're answering those questions for them so that we can actually get to the practicalities of doing these things. Also, I put myself through school for the PhD by teaching African languages online. So Chi, Yoruba, and Wolof, teaching those through my site, abibitumi.com. So Abibitumi, that translates to Black Power.
Okay.
And that's what we're all about, Black Power, Abibitumi. And basically the idea is that, you know, so many people, when they are interested in African liberation, they only talk about it in English or in French or in Portuguese. It's like, why would we have to talk about Black Power in the languages of our colonial enemies? That we need to actually speak about Black Power in African languages. So that was actually a coinage so that we can have that. Also, Abibi Fahundie, which is actually the name of my capoeira group, abibifahundie.com. So that translates to Black Liberation or African Liberation. So in all of our languages, Black and African are the same thing. So if you look at Pi, Obibini, the Bibi is the black part. So you say Obibini, Abibi mine, that's the land of black people.
Yeah.
If you look at Yoruba, Adulawa is those who are black in color.
Yeah.
That's what we call Africans. And then Ile Adulawa is Africa. If you look at Bamanankan, which is the Bamara language out of Mali, they say Farafin and Farafina for a black person. And Africa is the exact same thing. And Wolof Nitkunyul, it means black person, Real Nitkunyul, land of black people. If you look at Kikongo, You have Ndombe and Bandombe as plural. If you want to refer to this land that we call Africa as Nsiya Bandombe. Mm-hmm. Now, you would think, okay, maybe this is just a modern thing. But if you look at Kemet, this is the ancient, what they now call ancient Egypt. The land, actually, it means the exact same thing as Abibimanyi. It means land of black people. Yeah. And we call ourselves Kemetiu, which means black people. So this is our identity, that regardless of location, we are all black people. And this is why I even advocate that we need to start using those terms again. Because when you say African, you can have anyone who hops in there and says, look, I was born here, so I'm African. So here's a guy Chinese as the day he was born. Oh, look, I'm African because I was born here. So once we understand that Kemetiu is what we call ourselves, Kemeti singular, then we can understand that we're all Kemetiu regardless of location. So those Africans in Haiti, those are Kemetiu. And that too is Kemet if we understand what it actually means. In Haiti, that too is Kemet. If we understand it means land of black people, well, what land is blacker than that? It's a lot blacker than Morocco. So these are the things that we really have to get into the system.
Thank you so much for talking to us. I really appreciate it. I would love to shake your hand. And man, this is a lot of money, you know, so maybe I might take it and sell.
Well, this is why we do the capoeira, so that someone wants to take your money. You can get your capoeira on.
Wow, this is amazing.
Yeah.
Okay. Hope you guys enjoyed this amazing episode. It's your boy, Mr. Ghana Baby, right here in Ghana. I'll be in Togo on Saturday. So wait for your boy and let's take Togo to the world. Aya Maya.